Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon, everybody. It's not the right time to start panels about shopping mall before the lunch break. But anyway, we'll try to do it conservative very well. Especially we have two, I think, the food operator with us. They could make us feel a little bit not hungry. I'm delighted to moderate these panels, and it's a role that I done it in the previous part of my life and continue doing that in the shopping industry. And also I'm very delighted to attend the second Saudi retail forum. The first was in Jeddah 2019, and I was a part of the team that time. I'm very glad to see this kick off again back in Riyadh and the kingdom, in the capital, and I think this is, will add a value to the retail landscape in this country. We want to talk today about the future of the shopping malls, especially after this Vision 2030. We have a beautiful visions, big dreams. We have many of the real estate development happening in the country, the Giga project and all the programs, the good life programs and the tourism programs. And this is all reflected in our shopping industry landscape. I would like to start with my good friend from Alshaya, Mr. Mike. He is from the two sides of the formula, the retailer and the development also. And I would like to see his point view about the trend happening now in the country and how Alshaya Group look into it from a retailer side and also from developer. I know they're developing the Riyadh Avenues and Al Khobar Avenues. But in the same time, they do operate Bahrain and Kuwait also avenues. So, Mike.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah, we're sitting on two sides, you say. We've got 42 brands currently in Saudi Arabia, just over 1,000 stores trading. We have a partnership with a number of people, obviously Mabani, shopping mall in Kuwait and Bahrain, and we're investing in malls here. And the big malls, two malls. So investing is the word I use, and it's investing in the relationship. So if you talk purely about the malls we have currently, I first came to Saudi in, show my age, 2011. And over the first few months, I went from Tabuk down to Abha, from Jeddah, across to Dammam, and looked at all the mid, large-sized malls. We were in a lot of them. And my view was, and I'd been lucky enough to work in Asia, in Europe, and seen some what we would call world-class malls. And there were some very, very good malls in Saudi. And we have a good relationship. And but I think if you look at it, as you've just articulated, the future, the excitement, and the investment that Alshaya family are putting in Saudi, both in the people and the infrastructure, there's not a place like it. We heard this morning 40% of Saudi customers shopping outside. Outside the region, and all the things that have moved on so quickly. I never tire of telling my friends back in Europe and Britain what reality's like, as I've lived here for a number of years now, and my wife, about how the press back in Europe, and they talk about it differently, and the excitement of what's happening, the tourism, the development, the 2030 vision, which is a very, very good vision. So we're investing massively both in the relationships with the landlords. And I can think of those malls like Mall of Arabia and Mall of Dharan I saw in 2011. But if you think about the infrastructure and what's happening in the investment, the malls, we believe there's a big opportunity to raise our game, to have world-class malls. And people go off to Dubai. Do they go off for another 10% reduction in VAT or 5% in Bahrain? We think we can keep them here. And so that's what we're doing. But it's a long-term relationship. It's investing in the people, the infrastructure, and everything else.
Great. I would go to Mr. Faisal Alnasser. I know your Alandalus property is a developer, and they invest in retail property in the country. Now, there is a big leader in the market in development. The government is, through their subsidiary, they are also a developer. With all this giga project happening around the country, with all this entertainment, with all those hospitalities and all those type of mixed-use property around the country. How you find your guys, yourself, within this big picture? Do you think it is threatening to you? Is it complementary to you? Are you competing, or you are complementing the whole cycle of the business?
So, first, good afternoon to all, and it's a pleasure for me to be here and welcoming everyone here to Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. I hope you are enjoying your time here in Saudi Arabia, and not to be your first visit only, to be always a visitor to this country that we are proud of. Dear Mohammed, answering this indirect, you can see today with the Vision 2030, that's Crown Prince, is leading it with all the cabin of the government, and how big is it, and how, as you mentioned, those giga projects are happening in every place in the country, in Saudi Arabia, and especially in Riyadh, and even those latest announcement of Expo 2030 and the World Cup 2034. I think we can look to this from two different aspects. Many people will look to this as a threat to all the retailers, to the developers, to the property management, everyone. They will say that we are competing now with the government, with such a giant entity, which we can't do. However, I don't see it like this at all. I think today, all those big giga projects, what we name it, a giga project, this is an add to all the country, adding more people coming here. We are expecting a big number of tourism and visitors to the country. So this is, by a way or other, will be an adding to our market. So if we look at it as a threat, many people will look at the threat, but I think, no, it's not a threat. It's a good to have it in the country today. Good to have this big number of expected visitors, either in a religion areas like Mecca and Medina, either in the other cities, when you speak about Al-Ula, Red Sea, Al-Qiddiya, and Riyadh, Jeddah, Eastern region. So the expectation is very, very, very big on people coming in. You can take an example of other countries who was before us in Saudi Arabia who started this, this project. So if you go previously, like when you're going to London or Paris, or lately maybe in Dubai, those big projects is not killing the other market. It's always an adding those. However, it will be our duty that we develop ourselves. We come to a level that those projects are on. So we should not forget ourselves and not developing and enhancing our service we are provide, either as a retailer or as a property developer or. So I think the big competition is not the government and the giga project. The big competition for us is internally, that we need always to compete with those. We need to keep developing ourselves, keep providing the customers up to their expectation. Because today the customer expectation is not at all the same expectation that they are expecting it from 2 or 3 or even last year. People's expectation become very, very, very high, and we need to develop ourselves, enhancing the service we provide, show them something different so we can be up to their expectation.
Great. Mark, you come from the cinema industry.
Correct.
And the cinema industry, let's consider it, is young in this country, almost 5 years. Now, do you think the challenge happening in other parts of the country, the entertainment, affecting your business? That's number one. And number two, what is the trend in your side in selecting now the type of retail property you put your cinema inside? Is it the solo? Is it the lifestyle? Is it enclosed mall? Is it standalone malls? We need to hear your opinion about that.
So maybe if I just start off by saying, obviously, part of Vision 2030 is cultural reforms. So as part of cultural reforms is expanding on entertainment offerings in the kingdom, marketing entertainment offerings. So that will allow the economy to grow, so it'll contribute to the economy, but it'll also not only have things for residents to do, but also for tourism. So it'll also aid tourism. So again, like our colleague here alluded to, I don't think we should be concerned about these giga projects and everybody eating into the same pie. I think there may be pains that we're going through now, but I think long term, in terms of where the country's going and where the country needs to get to, we will all benefit off all these projects that are going on. In terms of our strategy, you know, we're very young in the kingdom, so it's been just 4.5 years. The cinema industry has grown tremendously over the last 4.5 years. We're now, the total industry is 60 cinema complexes, which is massive. To build 60 cinema complexes in a space of 4.5 years is unheard of anywhere in the world. The expansion was incredible even during COVID. So I think we're at the point now in the market where we will continue to grow, but there also has to be some form of consolidation. We just need to make sure that whatever properties that we're going into, we need to make sure that a proper due diligence is done, that there's the right market, that we have a market that's going to come to cinemas. The market is still very young, and it will grow, that, without a doubt. But we just need to make sure that wherever we're putting cinemas, that we're putting them into the right properties. There is an audience that will come to those cinemas, and we continue to grow the pie for everyone.
Great. Because we heard last week, one of your competitors, without mentioning any names, decided to pull out of the market, and they said it's a tough market. So we need you have to have your input on that.
Sure, it is a tough market, but it's not a tough market only in Saudi. It's a tough, the cinema industry worldwide is tough at the moment, and that's due to a number of factors. There's still the lag effect from COVID. As you know, cinemas worldwide were closed. Then if you look at even coming out of COVID, there was a lag effect in terms of the big Hollywood films and post-production. So we only really started seeing big Hollywood product a few this year that were coming out of post-production. The cinema business is content reliant. We rely on content. So there was a lag effect in terms of content coming through. And then we have effects as well, like this year we had, now in the latter part of the year, we had the writers and the actors strikes in the US, which means we have a further delay. So some big films that were supposed to release now in December have been pushed out till the middle of next year. So the business is tough, not only in Saudi, but worldwide. So what do we do as cinema operators? Well, we believe that this market going forward will be very similar to markets like South Korea, where local content is going to be very important.
Okay.
Local films from the region, Egypt, Saudi specifically, we've seen some great successes earlier this year in terms of Sattar, which was the biggest Saudi film of all time. This past weekend, we released another Saudi film called Mandoob, which opened as the biggest Saudi film of all time. As an example, Sattar, when it first opened earlier this year, opening weekend industry did 60,000 admissions. Mandoob this weekend did 90,000. So there's an appetite for local content. That's where our focus is, specifically from Muvi. We invested also last year in something called Muvi Studios, where we're not only an exhibitor now, we're now producing and co-producing films. We would like to see at least 24 productions being done by 2025 per year. So again, the focus is, it's a content-driven business. It's not only in Saudi where there's pain in terms of cinema business, and it's got to be about local content.
Great. So we understand the trend also is localization in the business of the cinema.
Absolutely.
Great. Walid, you are representing Azadea in the region and in the country. And I could see in your portfolio, as I understand, 70% is F&B. Okay. And tell us more about this trend, F&B with retailer. How is it doing in the country? Is localization also a part of your plans? And Arabic food or things? Tell us more about the trend in this business.
Okay. Azadea is a retail franchise operator, so what we do is represent international brands. Given that we have the majority of our champion brands already taken for the Saudi market, we have adjusted the strategy in terms of go more aggressive on F&B. We We believe that definitely the F&B component, and especially in the retail space, is going to be more and more a focal point going forward, because now with the e-commerce growth, double digit on yearly basis, people would need to have a certain, I would say, reason to go more frequently to the malls. So F&B is one of those components. Entertainment is another component. So, but as well at the same time, F&B specifically in Saudi is under heavy pressure. Not from, I would say, from that proliferation of brands and that rapid expansion. It's because if we would look at the major cost elements, if for anyone that runs an F&B business, it is much harder to generate a certain level of return similar to other GCC markets. I'd say the two main components are, I'd say, rent and people cost. And I don't think that this is a secret.
Sorry to interrupt you. Yeah. Is rent higher than other GCC country?
So the rent,
I doubted.
So rent in Saudi, the way it's structured, and we're seeing that things eventually are evolving going forward, because we're seeing more of partnership between the retailer and the landlord, and we're going to see more of that with the new developments, and as well the pressure that, I mean, more shopping centers are going to be under, is that rents are mainly based on fixed rent.
Okay. Not
so that, absolutely. So fixed rent doesn't really help much the retailer eventually to sustain a certain level of return to sustain the business. So we're gonna see more of a transition towards a TOR, which is a turnover rent going forward. This is one. Second, when it comes to the people cost from one element, you need to abide by certain regulations, which adds an additional burden on your cost. So I don't think, I mean, anyone from the audience that into that field won't be shocked if the people cost exceeds 30%, which is in reality in similar markets should be, I'd say, maybe in the low 20s.
Mohammed, you are in the shopping mall industry, operator, developer, and sometimes also advisory, I know that for that. You work in different markets in Egypt, Iraq, and Saudi. Recently, I think in Tabuk, Salma Mall, Hayal in Salma Mall, and also used to with Al Arkan. If you've been asked as advisory, the trend of the lifestyle malls, which going on now versus closed mall or street malls, what do you think the trend going to be in the next 5-10 years?
Thank you, Mohammed, and thank you all of you with this participation. Very glad to be in Saudi, in Riyadh again, and it's flourishing. Lifestyle malls are becoming now the trend all over the world. Me acting as a consultant and operator and developer also in many regions of the world, since COVID, really the lifestyle and human nature and habits have changed tremendously. Influencers and are becoming trendsetters today in fashion as well as in public spaces. What Saudi has succeeded to do during the last 3 years is to basically develop into an international hub of retail, lifestyle, shopping, entertainment. The super mega boulevard experience that is currently taking place now is definitely a case study for all of us who have been really wandering the world and trying to sort out on a checklist the success steps and success factors that one has to include in a project. I believe that the market has developed so quickly, and the people and the ground was not really ready for it. And we see it as you mentioned, in one of the famous operators in cinema getting out of the market, it's not because of competition, it's because of the such quick and speedy, how things are going so quick in this market. And all of us, you will agree with me somehow. Secondary cities are really losing grounds today. And all retailers, all developers, the government is really focusing on Riyadh, Jeddah, Khobar, and also, of course, the main touristic areas that has been there forever and were never considered Saudi land for many tourists coming from Europe with special planes and flights and charters and. The mega, super, mega projects taking place today and really turning the new facet of Saudi Arabia is amazing, and yet to see what the government is gonna be presenting to all of us, the new surprises on the market. Let me tackle what you discussed, Mohammed. One, retail operation. I believe there are great opportunities for local retailers, local Saudi retailers, to really nourish and basically to become regional operators and also maybe international operators. We are basically, Saudi is a little bit copying the Egyptian experience somehow. We have many brands around the room here today in Saudi, very interested to expand in Saudi, locally, regionally, and also maybe internationally. And we will see this more with Saudi brands. Young entrepreneurs, young lady entrepreneurs, and young businessmen going into co-working spaces, into e-gaming, into entertainment, into F&B, into family kitchens and home kitchens and local concepts and fashion concepts. This is really a great opportunity with what's happening today in Saudi. One, two, shopping centers. Classical shopping centers have to really change. They're becoming dinosaurs. They have to become now flying birds. I don't know what we can do in shopping centers today, but definitely the trend has to change to follow the lifestyle trends and everything that we do today. Food and beverage, the demographics and social interaction of families in Saudi Arabia has really pushed so quickly up the business of food and beverage and will continue, and this will flourish for many, many, many years. The good thing about this, that Saudi platform is a medium to high spending market, which is making the brands and the will not really see a crisis before at least 5, 6, 7, 8 years from now. And that's really the special things about the Saudi market.
Faisal, if you done 5 years ago a customer profile for your shopping mall, definitely you'll find it is almost 90% local residents versus 10% tourists or pilgrims or whatever. It varies from city to city. But this is changing now. Tourists are coming from all over the world, from GCC, from Arab country and things. So what do you think that the new trend in shopping mall to accommodate this new customer profile and the journey of your customers, what we should do and what you're doing and how we're going to be ready for that? I'll give you one example. When you go to Dubai Mall, you'll find the signage, Chinese, Russian, English, Arabic, everywhere. This is because the demographic and the visitors that needed to be there. What is your outlook on that subject?
I believe it's not only that. So if you allow me, I will go one step earlier. Today, if you go 5 years before, you will see only Saudi's families, who's the wife and maybe the kids, are going to visit the malls, only to do a task. So going to shop, going entering a shop, getting whatever they want, that's it. Maybe she will get something from food and privilege, and that's it. Today it's become a different. When you mean different, the following thing changed. So first, it's become a family trip. So wife and husband and kids are going, and they are making it as a day trip or an experience, and that includes shopping and food and privilege. The second thing that's not become only on Saudis. So the our brothers who's here as a residential and working in the country, now you can see them coming with their families more and more. So it's become not only Saudis and the residential as a family. So this is stage one was heaven and see it. And stage two, we start seeing, as you mentioned, that's the visitors from everywhere coming to either Riyadh, or the big cities, or even the religion cities like Mecca and Medina, and they are part of their trip is to visit the shopping malls and other destinations. Today, the clear that it's not any more shopping experience. It's more of, I will say, a day trip, or we'll name it visiting, including food and beverage, entertainment, and. So the shopping malls need to adopt this change in the social, adopt this change in the community, and preparing themselves to offer everything to whomever. So the wife expectation is different than the husband expectation, and different than the different age of the kids. So the young, different than the child's, and. So it's clear that shopping mall have a lot to do to fulfill all this expectation. This is number one. And number two, which is very important, you can see part of Vision 2030, there is big expectation of the visitors to Saudi Arabia. And it was clear that the number being achieved even earlier than 2030. So the target, it's been increased. So the expectation is going to be more. Additional to those new events that's been already assigned and Saudi Arabia winning it, so the expectation of visitors even going to be more. So today it's clear that all shopping malls need to step in if they want to get a piece of this cake, which is big number of visitors coming everywhere, and differentiate themselves first. So give an option to those visitors. Very important that this option to be have some of, I would say, our local touch and our local, taste. So you will have some local taste and providing them with something maybe they don't see it in their countries, in their home countries and others. So here where we need to work all the shopping malls in that direction, first to fulfill the expectation of the people who's living here, either Saudis or non-Saudis or expats, and to be ready for those big numbers. And when you mentioned Dubai Mall, you are right. And this, I think, Dubai Mall were leading on this by offering the big percentage of some of nationalities like Chinese, others, and celebrating their days. So I think this is very important, what we can see today, that we are celebrating and being part of the world days, being part of everywhere. So when now you visit many destinations in Riyadh or other places in Saudi Arabia, you see that it's not only focusing on Saudis only or whomever residential in the country. So I think a lot of things required from shopping mall. Expectation is high. Shopping mall need to step in this location if they want to survive. So a lot required at this stage.
Mike, could you tell us more now about the most weighted project avenues in Riyadh? And what is the new trend? How are you going to change the trend in the market? What is your opinion about the tech you want to use it? I know it's a mix between hotel, hospitalities, and I think offices, if I'm not wrong. So tell us more about how we're going to change the landscape of shopping mall in Riyadh.
Yeah, so our partner, Shamal Holding here in Saudi, and it is a big deal. It's public knowledge. It's the building of it, the infrastructure is 6.4 billion Saudi riyals, the one in Riyadh. We just announced the one in Khobar as well. So it's going to change, we think, dramatically. It's taking what we think is the best from around the world. It's 400,000 square meters in size. It's 1,400 retail units. It's outdoor, indoor. It's all the expected things like clinics and movies, cinema, exclusive brands and local brands, and parts of the world. Yeah, so it's going to be, we're very excited by it. It's meant to be ready by, and it's on target at the moment, for mid-26 Riyadh. And there's currently 9,000 people working there today, and up to 12,000 from January. So we're on schedule. But it's all about the customer. We do think, we believe, and as it's seen in the rest of the Middle East and probably the world, some of the mid-sized malls are getting a squeeze. And if they're not developing, so I agree with Faisal, they've got to develop, they've got to regenerate. And then you've got the local plazas here. But any of you have been, hopefully most of you in the room have been to Boulevard World. If you haven't, go there. And it really epitomizes what's happening in Saudi, the social, economic changes that are happening and people wanting to. So our mall has got to be experiential. It's got to be technology-wise. We've got different areas and zones. Yes, a lot of the things you see in Dubai Mall, it'll really move things on, we believe. The family are investing, the Alshaya family are investing majority of their money in Saudi over the next 7 years. We are really aligned to it, and we've invested massively in the last two new distribution centers. We've got a production factory for food now, run by Saudis, making the food for Saudi customers. So it's a balance of the local, but it's very exciting. And obviously it's very big, but we believe it can really work and raise customers. Hopefully they'll come and stay in Saudi rather than going elsewhere to shop.
Great. Mark, I visited your new concept in the cinema, the 360, and I have to say it's amazing. So tell us more about what is the trend in technology in cinema, and also how you could collaborate with the big event happening in the country, like the Expo, like the Formula, like the Cinema Festival, and all those things. Because I think all those have to be used, your event sort for promotion, or even for launching some of the activities.
Sure, so I mean, I think audiences in Saudi are tech savvy, firstly. So they will use technology, apps, etc. So we've invested heavily in our application and online channels recently. And a further extension of that is we are now digitizing the customer journey from the food and beverage point of view as well. So we're at the point where we're running a pilot where we now, you order your concessions via a kiosk at the cinema, and you're just collecting. You're no longer going and ordering from a human, very much like the McDonald's and a lot of the fast food outlets are starting to do as well. A further extension of that, which will be phase two, which we will launch in the new year, is at the same time when you're purchasing your tickets, you will also purchase your F&B. At the time when you are arriving at the mall, when you park in your car, whenever, you literally push and say, prepare my order. So we're looking at the customer journey, trying to make it as seamless as possible, as quick as possible, not standing in too many queues. So again, because I think Saudi customers generally are tech savvy, what we've seen already is they will adopt to this quite easily. And again, it's just making that journey as quick and seamless and as frictionless as possible. Your second question, looking at all these events, we have done some biggish events in our cinemas. We broadcast some football matches. We did recently private functions in terms of the Formula One that happened recently in Abu Dhabi. The issue when it comes to sporting events, though, is there's always rights issues, and it's trying to get the rights and find the rights. But there is definitely a place in terms of cinemas, the social space, getting people together, sharing an experience, and we have the space within the mall. So we're continuously looking at not only, again, content and local content, but we're also looking at what else we can do in these spaces and creating these social spaces for people to come and share experiences in.
Walid, could you elaborate a little bit about the growth of the online business and e-commerce in your portfolio? How much it represent? Maybe in the food, it's only the delivery, if there is the delivery systems, but the growth on it, the trend in Saudi, what is your expectation for that in the business?
Well, Mohammed, if we look globally, because Azadea represents, I mean, a wide portfolio of international brands in more than 13 different markets, we can see that e-commerce is gaining ground on double-digit growth on a yearly basis. And we expect that to continue for a while. Yet as well, that wouldn't be a secret that the majority of the global brands are more adopting the strategy of less is more, which is maybe less of stores, fewer stores, larger formats, really focusing on the experience. So the customer, when it comes interact with the product, live the full experience, and eventually have a wider coverage through the e-channels. When it comes to the F&B, I believe that it is still more of enjoying going physically to the restaurant whenever that customer eventually has time for it. And I believe, especially in this part of the world, people do still have time and do still enjoy eventually getting together and going to the restaurants. So it doesn't mean that each channel is not growing. It will keep on growing, but I wouldn't foresee having much of pressure on the physical network as much as in retail or in fashion.
Mohammed?
Mohammed, let me just
I need your comment because is mall dying or not yet?
Yeah, I have just to wrap. Developers should do is exactly what Dubai did or the Dubai developers did 10, 15 years ago. We were not waiting at the time to receive into our offices the retailers and the companies to just come and rent spaces. We were sourcing new concepts, sourcing new baby concepts, sourcing new restaurants from different countries in the world. I remember that, and most probably you did the same also when you were doing math many, many years ago. We were going to hit to knock doors in Lebanon, in Egypt, in Iraq, in Greece, in France, everywhere.
Mabic. Exactly. We go to Mabic.
Exactly. Absolutely. Year, absolutely. So I really believe that shopping centers in Saudi are becoming really massive, huge. And the net leasable areas are really getting into thousands, hundreds of thousands of square meters. And it's no way that companies like Azadea, Senomi, Al-Hukair, Al-Usaim, and other brands, Alshaya, of course, now it's really directing into your own projects more or less because you have such a big footprint of retail. So my piece of advice to developers, go and look for new brands. Saudi Arabia government is really easing up also for international non-Saudis to be able to operate in the market. It's true that the cost of operation is very high because of the staff. Eventually, I believe this is going to be changed, and maybe this is one of the things that you could be recommending to the government officials, again, is to try to open it a little bit more to non-Saudis to be able to, again, come back and work in the field of shopping centers and retail. Food and beverage is important, will continue to be. Lifestyle projects will continue to be. But basically, I think that the market is still very virgin. And again, please, Saudi investors and developers, do not overlook secondary cities. There are so many customers, so many potential disposable income into those cities. Try to, again, to continue and focus on them.
Thank you. Last comment from you, Mike, on the online business.
All our brands have got online e-commerce facility now in Saudi. It's worked well. We're getting double figure like-for-like growth, but it's still quite early for us. We've got some of our new brands like Charlotte Tilbury that are really surprising us because it's a beauty product. She likes to touch and feel and try the product. Got two stores, one in Red Sea Mallow, one in Riyadh Park, but online it's taking off really well. But it's also helped where we launched our digital loyalty app called Aura across all the brands, across all the markets in the Middle East. So you can use it anywhere. And it's a very, as we know, the Saudi customer, she's very savvy, as we talked about, technologically aware of what's going on. And that's really kicking on. We've, in just over a year, we've got 7.6 million people in the Middle East using the app, and 3 million already in Saudi. So it's exciting, but it's got a whole joined up, it is omni-channel, and this is where the big mal can really ask to work digitally as well. But yeah, it's It's a lot of work, but it's the right thing to do, and it's for Gen Z and millennials particularly, we're seeing quite a lot of penetration now with these things.
Okay, gentlemen, it was nice talking to you. Thank you very much. Time, I think, is finished, and thank you for our audience also.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. We are going to get a group photo at the front. If we can just take 2 minutes, and our photographer is right in the middle there. Lovely, all looking good. Whilst that photo is happening, ladies and gentlemen, I will let you know that lunch is served and you can go and carry on with your networking over there. And of course, we will be back at 2 p.m. for more jam-packed panels and keynotes. So thank you so much. See you this afternoon.